And hey, good evening. 5 minutes away from Firebrand Table Talk. I'm Teresa Croft of the Kingdom Messenger Network Web Radio. We simulcast Firebrand Table Talk on Spreaker Web Radio, and also we simulcast the video portion on Spreecast. Meanwhile, let's get some music in as we wait to the top of the hour for Firebrand Day. This is Jesus Cultural, Kim Walker, Break Every Chain. Firebrand Table Talk coming up.
Give it such a price.
And still standing by, Firebrand Table Talk. We'll continue the music. Matt Redman with Bless the Lord, Oh My Soul. It's the King of the Messenger Network Web Radio. Firebrand Table Talk coming up.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy. Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on saying. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy. Time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore, forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. Worship Your holy name. Come on. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship His holy.
Father, we're just grateful that we can lift up a song of praise and sing, make a melody unto Your name. It's an honor to be in Your presence, Father, tonight, this evening. The beginning of the Sabbath as You ordained it from the foundations of the world. Hallelujah. Lord, we just Come humbly before your throne tonight to obtain grace in an hour of need. Mercy needed for many that are some walking through the valley of the shadow of death, some needing a healing and a touch, Father, some suffering tremendously. The list seems like sometimes it just goes on and on and on. But Father, we know that all things are possible with you. So just speak the word, Father, and send your ministering spirits who are sent forth to aid those who will inherit eternal salvation, your word says. So we just thank you right now for not only the propitiation for the sins of all mankind have you made a way, but you've also made a way for us to walk in wholeness before you, spiritually, mentally, or in the soulish realm, and also in our bodies, health-wise. Spiritually, mentally, physically, financially, and socially, you desire to establish your covenant with us that we might be about your business. Hallelujah. So, Father, we just thank you for the honor it is to serve you and to seek you. And we just pray right now that you'll cause a desire to rise up within your children, Father, to want to know more of you, to want to seek you wholeheartedly, Father. Oh, as you carve your word upon our heart, mind, body, and soul, we can't help but know and feel and experience the liberating freedom as we worship you in truth and in spirit. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father, that your Holy Spirit brings all things to our remembrance. Father, we just pray that your kingdom would come to earth and touch earth, even as it is in heaven, so let it be here on earth. We're resolute in knowing that you're in control, you're in charge. Nobody else, no one else. Many may think they are, but we know who's in control. You are. You're sovereign. And so we are, because you are. We bless your name and thank you. Forgive us where we've missed the mark in words, thoughts, and deeds. Strengthen us, Father, to honor you and glorify you as we put our feet in the place where you've called us to walk, to be about holiness and righteousness. As we continue to go steadfast and be consistent, even in an hour of judgment that's come upon our country, we pray, Father, that you'll give your people the spirit of repentance, weeping and mourning for the sins of our country, not just for ourselves, but for the sins of our country. Deliver us from the bane of sexual immorality and idolatry that's caused such a spiral decadence of morality in our land. Oh, give us a heart that seeks after your heart. And it's not just for our sake that we ask that. But we ask that for all. Thank you, Father, for removing the blinders from our eyes and unstopping our ears that we may hear. Open our hearts and our minds unto you and to you alone as we submit to you and profess and confess that the words of our mouth and the meditation of our heart are only desirable to be pleasing unto you. We bless you and praise you for this opportunity. In the name of Yeshua, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Many things take us to a point of pungent sometimes, so we feel like we're being cut upon with a stiletto, and other times we think differently. But regardless of where we're at, the pruning process causes more growth and causes us to really ponder in our hearts, you know. And in every given situation, God always takes us to a place, and I marvel at God sometimes, because it's so funny. How did it get over there? This thing changed on its own. Wow. But I marvel at God sometimes, because wherever we're at and whatever we're going through, sometimes we have to stop in the middle of it, and we have to say, God, what are you trying to show me? What are you trying to teach me? What can I learn? What can I gain from this, Father? As he was talking to me and shared with me that the fruits of our life, hallelujah, they reveal how great the depth of love is we have for God, hallelujah. Sometimes we say things and people don't understand them. And so I was studying the Messiah after he arose, and I was also studying the Messiah as he walked upon the earth, and he shared some very important things with many of his disciples and many of the Pharisees. Not all the Pharisees and the Sadducees were against him, but they only sought him out privately. They wouldn't come to him any other way other than privately, secretly. They were afraid of being cast out of the synagogue and ostracized, and they were afraid of the power of their own people, their own religious leaders. And the funniest thing that we can get caught up in so easily is pride. And when we get caught up in pride, it leads to a downfall of many different sins. But the root is always pride, seems like. If we go back and we look at it, it's pride. And I was thinking about Christ not seeking honor from men, and he actually says that in John chapter 5. And I was thinking about his confrontation and to the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the religious leaders, and he wasn't intentionally trying to get some man that he had healed that had been afflicted for 38 years. He wasn't trying to get that man to break a Sabbath law. He was trying to get that man to a place of wholeness. And so the place of wholeness was for him to be able to take up his bed and walk. See, his bed wasn't where his bed was supposed to be to start with. Christ wasn't intentionally trying to get him to break the letter of the law. Absolutely not. Could you imagine having your place there at the pool, looking for the water to be stirred by an angel to go there? Could you imagine having your bed there? That wasn't his home. That was a place he camped out trying to get to healing, trying to get to wholeness. But God brought wholeness to him in that Christ came up to him and tells him, be made whole. Take up your bed and walk. It didn't matter to Christ that it was on the Sabbath. He wasn't trying to get the man to break some liturgical law, the letter of the law. No, not at all. He was trying to get the man back to a place where he would be comfortable living outside a place where he had camped for wholeness to come. Many times that's where we are, if we're honest. We're camped outside the doors of God's throne, trying to get to a place where God can move us. And God can bring revelation like he does to his sons and daughters. And he said those that are led by the Spirit are the sons and, if you will, the daughters of God. And sometimes we get so caught up into the letter of the law that we don't even want to allow God to be God. We've decided that it's going to be the way we want it to be. We've decided already who it is that deserves grace or who it is we want to receive grace. And you know, the Holy Spirit says that all are the children of God. Yet it also tells us that the ones that the Father draws unto the Son, those are the ones that are going to be saved. Those are the ones that are going to be born again. But we get so bent in our curve and in our motion or even revival mode that, you know, we're just going to save the world. God didn't call you to save the world. Christ is the Savior of the world. Hallelujah! Christ is the Savior of the world. It didn't happen the way the children of Israel of that day, let's just say it didn't happen the way that the Pharisees and the Sadducees had imagined that it was going to happen. And neither has everything lined up in your life the way you had planned it and thought it would be at this point in this stage. One of the most dangerous things that we get to is like that man in John chapter 5 that's by the pool. Sir, how can I ever get whole? I have no one, no man to come place me in the water first after the angel stirs the water. But yet when I'm trying to get there, another jumps in before me and receives. And I can't receive because it's only that first one that gets in. With Christ, it's not that way. It's not that way at all. Yet God's trying to get us to the place where we'll come into wholeness. If we'll just listen to his voice and follow his voice, not man's voice. Man says it's a sin for a guy to have long hair, yet God has a covenant people called a Nazarite that he separates from birth like he did Samson. Glory to God. No, Samson's strength wasn't in his hair.
Yeah, he lost his strength when they cut his hair off, but it wasn't because they cut his hair. It's because he revealed a secret that God told him that he should never do. God said, in the day that you reveal this, your strength shall leave you. It wasn't the fact they cut his hair that made his strength go away. It was the fact that he broke covenant with God. God's not interested in our sacrifices as much as he is in our obedience to him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We can make excuses and we can say, well, Christ died for all our sins, the ones we're going to commit. But that's not the mentality that God wants us to have. He says, be ye holy, be ye perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. See, God and man, our reasoning cannot be equal with God's. Hallelujah. Man says a woman in the liturgical setting is not supposed to preach and teach. Yet God said in his word that in the last days he'd pour out his spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters would prophesy. Your sons and your daughters would preach, because the spirit would be poured out without measure. Wow. The forerunner to Christ was John the Baptist. And he said, and if you're able to hear it, this is Elijah, though a forerunner that was to forecome. God's not a God of reincarnation. He was given a message. Many of you are forerunners before the great and awesome and terrible day of the Lord that's coming upon this earth. Yeah. But you see, we get to this place to where we believe that we have all the keys, we have all the answers, and therefore we're right. Mm. Okay. Wow. God has something very powerful to say about what we think and what we believe. And he tells us that whatsoever is not of faith is sin. So that removes this thing inside of us that says we found the way, we are the way, we have the way, we got it all figured out. But just when you think you've got it figured out, there's going to be something come along that's going to challenge you to the very depth and the very core of your being. Mm-hmm. God woke me up about a week ago, 4 o'clock in the morning. He began to share with me and talk to me. And, you know, a lot of times many ministers are at this place right now. They're at a crossroads in their life and they're looking around them and they don't see a lot of financial support. Never mind those that are praying and fasting for him and believe in God that he will just pour his spirit out upon them and work mighty miracles through them. Mm. But they don't see the financial gain that's coming in, and so they automatically assume that God must not be pleased with them. See, they begin to relate from a prosperity message. They begin to relate from a level of man instead of a level of God. They're not walking in faith. They're walking in the flesh or walking in carnality instead of the Spirit. But he said those that are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. See, to be led of the Spirit of God means that you know that the covenant has been established in the Word. He's already decreed it and declared it in the Word. Glory to God. So I don't get so moved in my emotions if I get a quote, word, unquote, or end quote. I don't get so moved in my emotions. Does it bless me when God confirms something? Absolutely. But where my faith and trust is in him to start with. And if he's decreed it and he's declared it in his word, I just expect it. Mm. Never base your identity or your worth to God on what somebody, as prosperity messengers say, sows into your life.
That's good. Okay.
Just because you're not receiving the amount of money that you think you should be receiving right now to be approved unto God. Mm-hmm. He said to study to show thyself approved unto God. A workman need not be ashamed. Rightfully dividing the word of truth. Mm-hmm. See, my focus is in the word. The enemy's always trying to throw things at you. Okay, he's trying to get you sidetracked. Listen, if all of Christ evidently knew what was coming, because in Matthew chapter 16, he changes Peter's name.
Mm.
Okay. And I want you to listen to what he says to him. He says, blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys to the kingdom, the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Mm-hmm. And you go back and you study and you get the Greek and you get the Hebrew, the Yiddish, if you will, and you begin to look up what Christ was talking about Hades. Mm-hmm. And you begin to understand what he's saying to this man right here, okay? Why did he say this? Because Peter had heard from the Holy Ghost, and he had responded from the Father's word to him. But who do you say that I am? Immediately you get the identity deep down on the inside of you, who the Son of God is. Something about you changes. The declaration is the word. The foundation is the word. Glory to God. It's not anything that someone else says to you. You may get a confirmation. You may have many words, if you will, spoken unto you. But your declaration has to come. Your foundation has to be based in the word. That's why it's important that you meditate. Blessed is a man who meditates in his word day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of waters, brings forth fruit. I mean, you just go through the scriptures. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord. I mean, you could just go through the scriptures and you can just pick out what God's saying to you about how important it is to have a root and a foundation in the word. Now, a lot of us, we have just enough of the word to be dangerous to other people. Okay? Now, I've been studying some things for a long time, and many times in our life, we'll get to an emotional breakdown. And if you're a minister tonight and you're looking for encouragement and you didn't get that encouragement because you didn't get that support that you needed, at the final moment when you need what you need, God's going to give it to you because he said he knows what you have need of even before you ask him. Amen. But don't base what you're receiving from another human being.
That's good.
That's right.
On whether or not God's approved of you, mm-hmm. or you're in God's perfect will.
Okay.
Never. That's such a dangerous thing to do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Such a dangerous thing to do.
Word,
when you're walking in obedience to God and you're in his perfect will, he said, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Friend, if you're suffering persecution, you know you have made the enemy mad.
Yeah, wow.
But whether or not you received that offering or that check that you thought you were going to receive has nothing to do with how pleasing you are to the Father. But his word tells you that he's going to give into your bosom through other people. You know why? Because he loves you. He's a good daddy. He's a good father. And he gives you the spirit on the inside of you that cries out, Abba, Daddy, Daddy God, help me in this situation. Now, if you're at your wits' end tonight, I got some good news for you. There's always hope. See, Jesus raised from the dead. Mary Magdalene cometh and tells the disciples, I have seen the Lord. And these things he said to me in John 20, verse 19. Now, when it was late that same day, the first of the week, and the doors were shut where the disciples were gathered together for the fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, peace be to you. The doors were shut. There was a great fear among the disciples because they had seen, and they had understood the malicious intent, the envy, the jealousy. They had understood that Christ, an innocent man, had died on a cross at the hands of brutal religious leaders. And you know what? And they were absolutely terrified. So they were having a secret meeting in a secret place. They were gathered behind doors secretly. And it says right in that 19th verse, for fear of the Jews. They could have went ahead and said for fear of the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the high priest. They could have put it right in there in that text. They didn't put it that way, but you can get a little more understanding if you'll go back to the Greek Orthodox. Mm-hmm. If you'll go back to the original text of the Hebrew and you'll begin to understand and receive these things. Now, well, the funny thing in John chapter 5, Christ again is telling them. He's telling them that that they thought because they had the law and they'd memorized the law that salvation had come unto them. Mm-hmm. And Christ was trying to tell them that everything in the letter of the law was pointing to him, because the law wasn't good enough. The sacrifice wasn't good enough. That's the reason it was a continual thing that was going on and on mm-hmm. and on and on and on. Mm-hmm. And he says, you think from the law you have been redeemed, and the law talks of me, yet you received me not. Mm-hmm. How many times has God told us something and we, with pride, turn our nose up, turn our head up, and we try to march on with our heart? It's funny. It's like running into a brick wall. Mm-hmm. If you could get enough speed up, you might be able to go through that wall. But I'm going to tell you something, not without some serious injury are you going to go through that wall, that brick wall. Hallelujah. And God makes a way through the blood of Christ. He brings us to a place in the humbling, if you will, of circumstances. Circumstances have nothing to do with how God feels about you. Mm. Just because you're going through a trial, he says in the water he's going to deliver you, in the fire he's going to deliver you. He says he's going to deliver you from the whirlwind, from the scourge of the tongue. Does that mean it's going to happen now when you want it? No. Does that mean everybody's going to get saved when you want them to get saved? No. But I know one thing, God is faithful, and his messengers, consistent messengers, are decreeing and declaring the promises of God that are yes and amen. If you latched hold of some promises from the book of Acts, and that's not the only place, but if you latched hold of those prophecies about you and your whole household being saved, that's awesome. That's great. Don't let go of it. Now, it may look like they're being scattered. It may look like your worst enemies might be some of those who are your own household. But that's okay, because really, there's no closer kin than the blood of Christ. Mm-hmm. See, he binds us together with cords that can't be broken. Mm-hmm. He makes us all one in the Spirit. Glory to God. When one suffers, we all suffer. When one's happy, we should all be rejoicing.
That's good.
Glory to God. We get hung up in this biological thing, and we think we've got it figured out. But really, our family is not limited to those that we were born to. Our family is those that do the will of God. Mm-hmm. Those that accomplish the will of the Father are those that we can become the closest to. Yeah. Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Yes, we do.
And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples therefore were glad when they saw the Lord. You know, a lot of us get to the place where we have to see a sign. God, you got to show me a sign. We start making all these deals with God. You got to make me know that. What? Who are you talking to? You're talking to the Creator. Oh my goodness. But how many of us, if we're honest, we get to this place and we say, wow, God's just not pleasing me. Just all this stuff's going on. And God just must not be. Did you base everything that you were going through upon the Word? Is your life consistent before God? Are you pleasing unto the Lord? Then you know it. The enemy wants you to believe something different. Yeah. And that's where the oppression begins to come in. When the oppression comes in, the only thing that's going to liberate you is the Master, Christ, the Messiah. Instantly you begin to praise him and worship him in truth and in spirit. That spirit of heaviness and that oppression to leave you. Glory to God.
Amen. Yes, glory to God.
Get off your pity pot. Get off your soapbox. Get up and dance and shout and sing before the Lord. Tell him how awesome he is and how grateful you are for the wonderful things that he has done for you. Watch the situation change before your eyes. Don't falter. A double-minded person's unstable in all their ways. Do not doubt for one minute that God's got you right in the palm of his hands.
It's good, baby.
God's in control. There may be many that think they're in control, but God's in control.
That's right. Whew. That's a good word, baby.
He was showing his side and his hands unto those to remove all doubt. The disciples therefore were glad when they saw the Lord. He said, therefore, to them again, peace be to you. He reiterated it twice, just as he's done many of us
in the day and the hour in which we leave. Live. We leave off our faith because the enemy brings doubt. Mm-hmm. We leave off our faith because we begin to fear. We begin to become fearful. Yeah. You can't serve both. Wow. He reiterated again, as the Father has sent me, I also send you. When he had said this, he breathed on this. Mm-hmm. And he said to them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Ruach HaKodesh. Whose sins you shall forgive, they are forgiven. And whose sins you shall retain, they are retained.
That's good.
Oh my goodness. Be careful with that. Okay? Be very careful with that. Okay? Because you can't get to a place of judgment. When Nathan came in to David, in Psalm 51, you hear David talking about a seed that was conceived in sin because he had gone into the Bathsheba and he had murdered Uriah, and the seed that was coming forth was birthed in sin and deception. And many of us have fruits that are coming up from the sin seeds that we planted a long time ago. Mm-hmm. But God is faithful. You have to be consistent. Yet Nathan the prophet didn't come in with judgment from himself upon David. He came in with the judgment from the Lord. He didn't come in as a man judging the king. He came in as a humble servant, yet he spoke the judgment of the Lord. You know, there's always accountability and responsibility with Yeshua. Mm-hmm. Not all of us are willing to be responsible and accountable. Now, he's telling you right there, the sins you retain, they're retained. But you have to be careful that when you retain somebody's and you're unwilling to forgive, you know, the word says, if you forgive men their trespasses, so the Heavenly Father will also forgive you your trespasses. You have the right to curse somebody in the name of the Lord. But can you be, in all sincerity and honesty, can you be to a place where you can retain the sins and not walk in offense? Because if you can't retain the sins and not walk in offense, you're erring. You are erring. Now, there's a difference in accountability and responsibility. Okay. When you decide, mm-hmm. when you decide that you've had enough, okay, and you're going to make a stand in an indignant way, righteous anger for God, and you're going to become strong-willed toward someone, and you're making a statement, and you're saying, I want to see some consistency in your life. You've hurt me a lot. I forgive you. I love you. I want to see some consistency, because you're throwing somebody's past up all the time, or you walking in a place where you shouldn't be, or you bringing up offenses that you've already walked through because you're failing to serve God with all your heart, and you're bringing all this pain upon, unneeded pain upon other members of the body of Christ because you're failing to walk in consistency. See, that's the first thing the enemy does. Immediately you let go of the hand of God, and oppression and fear and doubt and worry, you begin to sin, you begin to fall away, and immediately the first thing he does to you is convinces you that you're not forgiven of all that stuff that you've already been forgiven for before. Mm-hmm. See? So in your mind, you go back and you start all over again. And isn't it funny that the first thing that comes out of your mouth is it's always somebody else's fault? Mm-hmm. God cleanse me from all unrighteousness. God help me to see the error of my ways. God help me remove the log from my eye so that I might clearly see how to help somebody get the splinter out of theirs. Hallelujah. Glory to his name. Mm-hmm. There's nothing like receiving grace. And just because you receive grace doesn't mean that that door that got slammed in your face will always continue to be slammed in your face.
That's good.
But just because you got grace doesn't mean that that door is going to swing wide open like it did before. Hallelujah. God says, even in his word, don't put a new convert in charge of anything. A new convert, a proselyte. Don't let him be in charge of anything. See, you have to be rooted and grounded and established.
Right.
There's processes of healing. There's a process of healing. The first thing you need to ask yourself, I do, is why I think it's somebody else's fault that I am where I am. Or I feel the way I do because somebody else did something. This is just everyday stuff. This is everyday life. This is what families all over the world are struggling with right now. Because this is the attack of the enemy to try to destroy families. Hey, you got a son or a daughter that don't want you to be their parent? There's nothing you can do about it. Or, hey, you're a kid and you've got somebody that doesn't really want you to be their child. There's nothing you can do about it. You can pray about it. You can fast about it. But you're not going to change it. God's the one that's got to change it.
Right.
See? But if you begin to carry it and you begin to believe that you're the one that's going to change it, you've already erred. And this is a serious time. And so the enemy's throwing everything he can against us to get us off focus. Our focus has to be on the Word and the will of the Father. The Word of God and the will of the Father. And you ask yourself, for me. I'm not talking about where Joshua had already made up his mind and said, as for me and my house, we serve the Lord. That's a given. Okay, I'm talking about the will of the Father. What is the will of the Father for you right now in your life? There's such this confusion that's going around of obfuscation, bewilderment, if you will, frustration, if you will, that says, well, I'm just not sure what God wants me to do. I don't know what He's called me to do. Your gifts are so evident. That's that's the enemy trying to blind you from the path that God wants you to take so that you can grow in His grace even more and become more fruitful for Him. Is it painful to be pruned? Absolutely. Yes. Is it painful? Is it painful? Absolutely. But when the Holy Ghost takes out His stiletto, it's with laser precision. He knows what He's doing. He knows what we have need of to bear more fruit for Him. Immediately you begin to carry things, you begin to get out. Now all of us have to process it. You may have to get in a group setting, you may have to get with some people, and you may have to sit down, you may have to tell them why you feel this way, well, this is the emotion that you feel. You may have to get it all out, but when you get it all out, get rid of it. Don't carry it. Don't hold on to it.
That's good.
Because opinions, right here, opinions go here in judgment. As soon as you get there in judgment, you're walking in offense. And you know what you allow? A stronghold. The enemy has no power over you. The keys to the kingdom of heaven belong to you. Don't give up your authority. I don't care what the enemy's done. I don't care what he's saying. Don't give up your authority. You're worthy. You're loved. You're important. You're a chosen vessel. You're the apple of God's eye. You're His son or daughter. You have meaning. You have purpose.
That's good.
Glory. Now, get rid of your pride. If God's called you to get in touch with somebody, get in touch with them. Don't walk in that pride. Walk in love. Love is the keys to the kingdom of heaven. That love and that key is Christ, Yeshua, Jesus, if you will, the Messiah of all mankind. Of all the world. Friends, if you don't know the Messiah, there's a few simple steps that you take. You begin to confess your sins, your faults before Him. You ask Him to forgive you and ask Him to come in and make His home in your heart. And He and the Father will come in. You will begin to see newness of life in areas that you thought would never come back to life.
Amen.
Forget about the bad seeds you sowed. Just keep sowing the good seeds. Because the good fruit is going to come forth as He plants you as a tree of righteousness in His honor. The Word teaches us to seek the honor of others. We can't seek the honor of others if we're so busy promoting ourselves.
Sure.
Let God raise you up. Humble yourself in the sight of the Lord, and He shall exalt you in due time.
Amen.
There's some rewards that He's getting ready to give folks that have been waiting for a long time. I feel it in my spirit that you've been in a desert and like an oasis in the desert. Could you imagine Hagar? Nothing else to eat, nothing else to drink. Gives the kid the last drink of water and an angel appears to her and leads her right straight to an oasis. Could you imagine an oasis in the desert? That's what Christ is to you, to your soul. Christ is the oasis. Be at peace. Forgive.